Good evening, everyone. It's 7 o'clock and it's time to start our service. Thomas is ready to go. We're going to be in Revelation chapter 14, the latter half of Revelation 14. So I hope that you'll take your Bibles and join us tonight. If you're driving in, keep on driving. Make sure that you get here just as soon as you can. I wanted to remind everybody that we will be receiving an offering, and we'll do it just like we do on Sunday morning. The offering plates are here, two in the front and two in the back of the sanctuary, and so you can go by and visit those. I think I've got mine ready to go, and I'll be dropping that in just a moment. And we're going to let Thomas come up in a second, and he is going to start the service, the Bible study tonight, and then he'll be concluding as well. But join me in prayer, everyone. Father, in the name of Jesus, I pray that you'll be with us tonight, and God bless this offering. And I pray that you'll lay your hand upon Thomas, touch him, Lord Jesus. And I pray give us a feast of the word tonight. In the precious name of Jesus, I ask, amen. Amen.
All right, welcome once again. Wouldn't want to be anywhere else besides right here doing just this for the work of the Lord. We are in Revelation chapter 14, and we covered the majority of the assurances last time, and we'll be covering the remainder of those assurances. But before we get into Revelation 14, I just want to open up in the book of Psalms in chapter 27. Now, we're living in an ever-changing world, and recently we just paid our respects and honor to those that lost their lives in the military. And we look and we remind ourselves of those that are sacrificing so many, and our forefathers that sacrificed so much, that held on to the principles of God, that were directed on the paths that they needed to go, and they abided and trusted in the Lord. It didn't make any difference. They knew with what they had to do, and that's exactly what they were doing. But I want to open up something that David had wrote in Psalms 27, beginning with verse 1. The Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? The Lord is the strength of my life, and whom shall I be afraid? When the wicked, even mine enemies and my foes, came upon me to eat my flesh, they stumble and fail. Though a host should encamp against me, my heart shall not fear. Though war should rise against me, in this will I be confident. One thing I desire of the Lord, that will I seek after, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, to behold the beauty of the Lord and to inquire in his temple. For in a time of trouble he shall hide me in his pavilion. In the secret of his tabernacle shall he hide me. He shall set me up upon a rock, and now shall my head be lifted up above mine enemies round about me. Therefore I will offer in his tabernacle sacrifices of joy. I will sing, yea, I will sing praises unto the Lord. Hear, O Lord, when I cry with my voice, have mercy also upon me and answer me. When thou sayest, seek my face, my heart saith unto thee, thy face, Lord, will I seek. Hide not thy face from me. Put not thy servant away in anger. Thou hast been my help. Leave me not, neither forsake me, O God of my salvation. When my father and my mother forsake me, then the Lord will take me up. Teach me the way, O Lord, and lead me in a plain path because of mine enemies. Deliver me not over unto the will of mine enemies, for false witnesses are risen up against me in such a breath. Out cruelty I have fainted unless I have believed. To see the goodness of the Lord in the hand of the living, wait on the Lord. Be of good courage, and he shall strengthen thine heart. Wait, I say, on the Lord. We go back and we look at what David was all about, and he was a man that was after God's own heart. He was a God that believed in the praises, and he believed in what God promised as far as he inhabited the praises of men. He knew all too well if we were going to be get the attention of God that He desires the praises of His children. But then we stop, we reflect. We think about a Memorial Day, what it means to be frozen in fear. So when those guys go back and they're on the front lines and they're serving, they put themselves ahead of all of their fellow people that's right beside them. They have their interests slightly ahead of their own interests. They're ready to do whatever they got to do to protect their fellow man at all times. They live as if they've already dead. They do what they got to do. They are to protect each other, and that's what's built into them. But every now and then, there may be just one person. There may just be one that decides they don't want to be part of that helping person. And they may go the other way. They may run the other direction. And if they do, that's because we can't trust all men. But there's one that we can absolutely trust no matter what, the one that'll be with us no matter how we look at it. And that's God Almighty. God Almighty will always be there for us. It doesn't make any difference. He's not going to forsake us in any circumstance whatsoever. He's going to be right there with us all the way to the end. When spiritual darts are thrown away in our mindsets, we're going to sit and we're just going to have our faith put up. And we're going to put the armor of God on. And we're going to prevent any kind of snarls, any kind of fiery darts going our way. Because we're going to put all of our trust in the Lord. We have men that's going to put their trust, and they're going to go out and they're going to help each other as much as they possibly can. But we have to be very careful putting any kind of trust in any kind of man, because we'll be very disappointed if we do. There's only one that we should put our trust in. There's only one. But we look and we know that we can open up in prayer and we can have the absolute utmost good intentions that we possibly can have in our minds. But here's the thing. Even with David and all of his godly ways about him, looking after God's own heart, trying to search, trying to be the best that he can, he knows beyond a shadow of a doubt that whenever it comes time for fear, he has fear in his life just as well. But he knows what he has to do. And that's the first verses. It's to proclaim God. It's to proclaim what it's all about before he gets moving any further down in the scripture. But it's that time whenever we can start praying and we're searching for God. We're trying to know exactly what we're trying to get through. And fear can overtake us before we get done even saying what that prayer is, before we even close. If David can change on the dime, even biblical scholars look at this and say it's not even possible for a man to be able to change so quickly, to have so much faith and then end up with so much fear all in the same breath. But it's okay, because that's who we are, and fear is acceptable as long as we proclaim God first, so that when we do pray, we're praying in faith and we're not praying in doubt. We know that He's going to be our protector. We have to embrace fear, and through Jesus we can overcome absolutely anything. It doesn't make any difference. Whenever we know that there's going to be a time for fear, we just have to embrace it and proclaim the blood. Proclaim what we have at the beginning, and we won't have anything to worry about. What does the Bible tell us? It says, profess our faith, seek the Lord and pray, wait patiently for the Lord to meet those needs. And while you're doing that, be strong and be courageous. We have to remember the Word of God is our weapon against spiritual foes, and it's effective in slaying strongholds in our lives, including the stronghold of fear found in Ephesians 6 and 17. But we look at this, and then we are so quick to go from a memorial service, and we look around the world. Memorial's on Monday, and we look back and we see so many RVs and campers, and there's no honor in it. It's all about self. It's about going and doing this and doing that and the other. We need to remember to honor those that give us the liberties and the freedoms that come at a cost. We have to remember and honor those that give us the ability to do this. We have to remember to honor Jesus Christ. that give them the ability and put them on the road that we know that we can walk down. We don't want to get on the wrong road and then just as quick as everything, it's going from a state of honor and then it turns into a state of rights. And it's all too quick to know that rights maybe appear somewhat spontaneous, but whenever you have someone that has an emotional outbreak that is full of rage and full of anger, if they become just to a certain degree of an influence, and you have so many people that's willing to travel out into the world to do whatever it is when they are absolutely ready to do anything that leader would have them to do, just because they want to be part of something, to be accepted into something. But we need to remain godly, and we need to remember that we don't need to be acceptance to the world whatsoever, but we need to be acceptance to Jesus Christ. We need to make sure that we put Him first and above all things. There's nothing biblical about rights. Even though we had some examples in the Bible, we had some that's in Ephesus, and we have some here, and we have some there. But there's one right that brought back to my attention when I was reading through this, and I thought, my goodness, how easy and how quick it is for men to change their mind from faith to fear. We go back and we look. We had Paul, a victim of rioters, in 2 Corinthians 6 and 5, in Acts 17, verse 5, and Acts 19. But it's all at the heart of jealousy and deception, at the heart, hate-filled agenda. And we talked about it. It's so many people don't even know what they were doing. They don't even know why they were there. But it's the mentality of exactly what's going on. They just want to be part of the clique. I just want to do what I got to do to be accepted into this world. But when we go back and we look, and if we remember Pilate, it was so quick that we go from one chapter to where people were all about singing Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. We love you, we praise you, to where there was an influence. There was a compromise that happened. And when this compromise happens, people are so quick to change direction. It only took literally four more chapters down, and it went from Hosanna to Hosanna to crucify Him, crucify Him. How quick it is to turn our backs when we have just a slight bit of influence that's impacting us. How quick it is that we change. We go back and we look at Revelation, and we had the 144,000, and we look how quick it is for people to change whenever there's just such a small influence that happens. Just a small influencer, someone that I can follow, someone that I can be with, someone that I'm going to back. But we remember, what did Jesus say? Forgive them, for they know not what they do. It's the same basic foundation. Forgive them, for they know not what they do. We were doing all of this in our own right, not even realizing what we were doing. We were killing the Son of God, Jesus Christ. How quickly they turned against Him. And it wasn't an agenda other than what it normally is. The religionist begins to get jealous. It's all about material. It's all about everything that we talked about. It's those seven churches that's completely negative in every aspect. So if you combine those characteristics across the board, when men become full of everything that's anti-God, this is exactly what happens. We end up in a shape to where we turn our backs on Jesus. And then we have to sit and think how easy it is. What happens if we don't make the rapture? How hard is it going to be for those to be able to stand up to the most powerful, influential leader of the time, backed by all the spiritual darkness and all the demons that roam the earth at that time? I don't think that there's going to be any way that it's going to be an easy way whatsoever. But we get down and we look. We've had plenty of assurances across chapter 14 in Revelation. We have the assurance that the redeemed will be with Jesus Christ. We have the assurance that the gospel will be preached to the whole world. The Bible says, Babylon, the godless state, and religion will fall. Justice will be executed. We have the assurance that the dead will be at rest and rewarded. And we have the assurance that the glorious harvest of the godly will take place. And we have some more assurances that the ungodly harvest will as well take place. No matter how we look at it, Jesus Christ is going to be victorious over all the ungodly and over all the evil in this world, no matter how we look at it. There's going to be two distinct angels in this passage. Jesus is going to triumph and have his glory no matter what and no matter how we look at it. In the last days of human history, he's coming back and he's going to harvest the earth. As the Bible points out, he's going to judge the ungodly and the evil. Jesus and his followers will be vindicated. The world will see exactly who the Son of God is. And for those that never put their trust in him, it's going to be way too late. Whenever it comes time that God cannot take it anymore, when it's time to come, he's going to release the judgment. And it's going to be too late for those that are not on his side. Either you're going to be with him or you're going to be against him. But it's time. It's time for vindication to start. The world will see and the world will know for those that stood by him that it'll be certainly worth all things. It'll be certainly worth all the sacrifice. It'll be worth all of those that remain after the rapture. That it was worth all the persecution that they went through. It was worth hiding in all the places. It was worth all of the places that they reached out and prayed with every ounce that they had in them for protection during that time period so that they wouldn't be killed and slaughtered like so many of the other ones that denied Jesus. The world will eventually know it, and that every knee will bow. But this sixth great assurance is to the believers that the day of harvest is coming. The reaping is going to come. The believer is going to be taken home to heaven to live with God forever and ever and ever in Christ. And all the evil will be shut out from God's presence. We'll not have to worry about anything anymore. There's going to be a heavenly, it's going to be beautiful. We just have to make it there. We got to make sure that we're not left on the latter half of the harvest. We got to make sure that we're on the forefront. And we have to suffer through the temptations and trials of life and make sure that we stay on the right path and the right road, no matter what it is. We got to be like Paul and do everything we possibly can to the point of exhaustion. We got to make sure that we live in the Spirit and we get rid of the carnal thinking. We got to understand what the reaping is all about. We'll flip from literal thinking to spiritual thinking and understand what this reaping is all about. But this title stresses the ideal servant of a man. He came as a servant to all of us. He came to serve all of us and to teach us all of the different things, to be empathetic, to be compassionate. He was betrayed. He endured every single emotion of loneliness, of rejection, of every single thing that we can possibly throw at him, along with the physical pain. 100% man, volunteered, so that he can understand what it is that we're going to have to go through. And 100% God, to allow us to be redeemed, and allow us to overcome, as Romans chapter 8 points out to us in so many times, a battle against the flesh that we have to overcome. We just have to believe it. So many rebel against this idea. They may be partial and they may believe just bits and pieces of it. But he's going to return back in a white cloud symbolizing the purity of heaven from the world of purity and godliness. Purity and godliness of heaven to bring purity and godliness to the whole universe. He'll be wearing a gold crown. Royalty, rule and dominion and sovereignty over all as the new world comes into formation. But it says here that Jesus will return with the sharp sickle in his hand. Got two of them with a long knife. This is a pictorial to use to harvest the grains of the fields. A picture of judgment. In the end time, when Jesus Christ returns, he'll be returning with a sickle in his hand, returning to judge the world. We go back and look at Revelation 1 and 7. Behold, he cometh with clouds, and every eye shall see him, and they also who pierced him, and all kindreds of the earth shall wail because of him. Even so, amen. And then we look at John chapter 5, verses 26 through 27. For as the Father hath lived life in himself, so hath he given to the Son to have life in himself. And he hath given him authority to execute judgment also, because he is the Son of Man. He comes in complete authority to release judgment. Then there's the harvest of the earth, the separation of the believers from all of the ungodly of the earth. This scene, if we look at it, it's completely awesome and spectacular. It's looking over all of the earth with a sickle in his hand, everyone noticing, everyone seeing him. But it means fear and horror to ones that know that they're not right with God. It's fear and horror. It grips their heart to the core. But we know that the harvest of the earth will be ripe. It's time. It doesn't, no more time for any more ripeness. No more time to correct the corrupt fruit or the corrupt anything that's going on. It's done. And an angel comes out of the temple, out of heaven itself. He comes out of the very presence of God and bringing the very message of God. The harvest is ready. The harvest of the earth is ripe. The shout of the angel is, thrust in your sickle and reap. And we know that this is going to be that separation. This is going to be that protection. Those that suffered at the hands of the Antichrist, that endured and went on through all of the tribulation that the Bible talks about in Revelation. The heart of Christ, as much as he longs for people to be saved, there's a limit. There's a point of no return. He can only take so much. And once that time has elapsed, that's it. It's not just him. But whenever his people are being slaughtered and persecuted and tormented, he's still a God that doesn't change. He's still a God of empathy and compassion and a God that loves his people. And there's only so much that it's going to be able to be withstood. It's time for the harvest. And thank God. Then once that happens, never again will we have to be suffer from hunger or cold, heat, disease, accident, trials. But the Bible tells us that we won't have to even have a single tear anymore. He's going to wipe away every tear. But those that trust in Jesus through this time are going to be rewarded once and for all. Those that love to him and gone before him, he's going to take that form of that great mass of society to populate the new heavens and the new earth. We continue on and we look, if we look back at Matthew 13, verse 30, let both grow together until the harvest. And in the time of the harvest, I will say to the reapers, gather together ye first the tares and bind them in bundles to burn them, but gather the wheat into my barn. He's constantly telling us to be prepared for this time. In Matthew 13, verse 49, so shall it be at the end of the world, the angels shall come forth and sever the wicked from among the just. This is exactly what's happening in Revelation 14. And we go and look at 25 and 32 in Matthew. And before him shall be gathered all nations, and he shall separate them one from another, as a shepherd divideth his sheep from the goats. And we look at Luke 3 and 17, whose fan is in his hand, and he will thoroughly purge his floor, and will gather the wheat into his garner, but the chaff he will burn with fire, unquenchable. And we can go on and on with verses and verses that support everything that's happening in Revelation 14. But then we have the assurance as well. We have all of the wonderful assurances, and then we have that terrible harvest of the ungodly that's going to take place as well. The harvest of all the ungodly, a picture that is just brings horror to even read, a pictorial that John had to endure. But with No wonder that Jesus has had to give him a slight break so that he could even continue on, because he knew what was coming. He knew what future was coming right in behind it. So as John gets his breath and he continues to jot down all of these words in the Bible and this picture, we go on in verse number 17, and there's another great angel, and the harvest of the ungodly is happening until we get to verse 20, the terror of Armageddon, the place where the wrath of God chiefly falls. We look, and it comes out of the temple of God, directly from heaven, from the very presence. God on a very special mission for God. He holds a sickle in his hand, the threshing tool of the farmer, the vineyard keeper. But there's terror in the cry of the angel. This is the second angel. But where it's coming from, we talked about the incense that's kept, the prayers that's kept up. We always wonder where the prayers are. They're kept right there, stored up as incense. And he's protecting those that we talked about from the altar where every single one of these are kept. All the martyred saints are stationed right there in heaven. And they're just waiting. All the millions that's been martyred through the centuries, and there'll be millions more martyred. But the angel here has power of fire. It's all about God's judgment to be cast upon the earth and all the believers to be consumed, unbelievers to be consumed. There are two vines in the earth, the vine of Jesus Christ and the vine of the world. Jesus Christ said that he is the vine and his followers are the branches. We read that in John 15 and 5, I am the vine, you are the branches. He that abideth in me and I in him, the same bringeth forth much fruit. For without me, you can do nothing. This passage also says that the earth has a vine of worldliness and ungodliness and pure evil, a vine that will reach its full growth in the end time and with the Antichrist and all the followers. Found in verse number 18, thrust in thy sharp sickle and gather the clusters of the vine of the earth, for her grapes are fully ripe. In Matthew 4:29, but when the fruit is brought forth immediately, he putteth in the sickle, because the harvest is come. We look at this, and we look at so many parables, but what is this winepress? What is this winepress of God's wrath? We look, and the trampling of the grapes were absolutely deliberate and absolutely purposeful. The grapes were to be trampled underfoot. That means that there's not going to be any kind of compassion or empathy or anything of the such. The trampling of the grapes was very thorough. There's not going to be a single bit of an exception. There's not going to be anyone, oh, I'm going to give you a second chance. There's not going to be any partiality. The Bible declares it through and through. He will never show favoritism for anyone. It's either all or none. It can't be like Laodicea. It can't be hot and cold, because he'll spew you out of his mouth. But we see again in Revelation 19 and 15, one more reference. And out of his mouth goeth a sharp sword, that with it should be smite the nations, and he shall rule them with a rod of iron, and he treadeth the winepress of the fierceness and wrath of Almighty God. And here it is that we're now landed into the Armageddon. So quick that we see this picture of the military, in a literal sense, getting ready. The great battle of Armageddon, the great day of the Lord. This final battle of human history as we know it. The Antichrist and all of his armies and all of his followers are gathered together. And the midnight hour of judgment is going to strike. The time for God's eternal judgment and wrath is going to come. The quickest defeat in human history, again, as we all know, is going to be because we all know where the power is. The power is always has been and always will be simply the Word. The Word. That's where our power is, and that's where Jesus' power lies. And it's just going to be his word that spreads out in a consuming fire of judgment. It's painted throughout this judgment, the army of the ungodly and all their glory and might will be immediately and thoroughly destroyed by the winepress of God's wrath. We look at several different images found in Isaiah, Joel, Revelation, and 2 Thessalonians. None of them at all a pretty picture whatsoever. In Isaiah 63, who is this that cometh from Edom, who dyeth garments from Boaz? This that is glorious in his apparel, traveling in the greatness of his strength. That speaking righteousness, mighty to save. Wherefore art thou red in thine apparel, and like and thy garments like him that treadeth in the winefat. I have trodden the winepress alone, and the people there was none with me. I will tread them in my anger, and trample them in my fury, and their blood shall be sprinkled upon my garments, and I will stain all my raiment, for the day of the vengeance is in mine heart. And the year of my redeemed is come, and I looked, and there was none to help, and I wondered that there was none to uphold. Therefore my own arm brought salvation unto me in my fury. It upheld me. And I will tread down the people in mine anger and make them drunk in my fury. And I will bring down their strength to the earth. And then in Joel chapter 3, verses 9 through 17, proclaim ye this among the Gentiles. Prepare war. Wake up, thy mighty men. Let all the men of war draw near. Let them come up, beat your plowshares into the swords, and your pruning hooks into spears. Let the weak say, I am strong. Assemble yourselves and come, all you heathen, and gather yourselves together round about. Dare to cause thy mighty ones to come down, O Lord. Let the heathen be wakened and come up to the valley of Jehoshaphat, where there I will sit to judge all the heathen round about. Put you in the sickle, for the harvest is ripe. Come, get ye down, for the press is full, and vats overflow. For their wickedness is great, multitudes, multitudes in the valley of decision. For the day of the Lord is near in the valley of decision. The sun and the moon shall be darkened, and the stars shall withdraw their shining. The Lord also shall roar out of Zion, and utter his voice from Jerusalem, and the heavens and the earth shall shake. But the Lord will be the hope of his people, and the strength of the children of Israel. So shall ye know that I am the Lord your God, dwelling in Zion, my holy mountain. Then shall Jerusalem be holy, and there shall be no strangers or ungodly heathen pass through here anymore. And if we look at Revelation 19, we'll take a peek at that one. 19, and he was clothed with a vesture dipped in blood, and his name is called the Word of God. And the armies which were in heaven followed him upon white horses, clothed in fine linen, white and clean. And out of his mouth goeth a sharp sword, that with it it should smite the nations, and he shall rule them with a rod of iron, and he treadeth the winepress of the fierceness and wrath of God Almighty God, and the half of his vesture on his thigh a name written, King of Kings and Lord of Lords. And I saw an angel standing in the sun, and he cried with a loud voice, saying to all the fowls that fly in the midst of heaven, come and gather yourselves together into the supper of the great God, that ye may eat the flesh of the kings, and the flesh of captains, and the flesh of mighty men, and the flesh of horses, and of them that sit on them, and the flesh of all men, both free and bond, both small and great. And I saw the beast, the Antichrist, the kings of the earth, and their armies gathered together to make war against him that sat on the horse, and against his army. And the beast was taken, and with him the false prophet that wrought miracles before him, with which he deceiveth them that had received the mark of the beast, and them that worshipped his image. These were both cast alive into the lake of fire, burning with brimstone. And the remnant were slain with the sword of him that sat upon the horse, which sword proceeded out of his mouth. And all the fowls were filled with their flesh. And one more, and that's found in Thessalonians, 2 Thessalonians chapter 2. Verses 8 through 12. And then shall the wicked be revealed, whom the Lord shall consume with the spirit of his mouth, his word, and shall destroy with the brightness of his coming, his glory, even him, whose coming is after the working of Satan with all powers and signs and lying wonders, and with all deceitfulness of the unrighteous and them that perish, believe they receive not the love of the truth, that they might be saved. And for this cause, God shall send them strong delusion, that they should believe a lie, that they all might be damned who believe not the truth, but had pleasure in unrighteousness. All of those are very highly pictorial elements that reference to all of this wine press and God's wrath. But let's look just for a second and go back to John 15. John 15 says that I am the true vine, and my Father is the husbandman. Every branch in me that beareth not fruit, he taketh away, and every branch that beareth fruit, he purgeth it, and it might bring forth more fruit. Now ye are clean through the word which I have spoken unto you. Abide in me, and I in you. As the branch cannot bear fruit of itself, except it abide in the vine, no more can you, except ye abide in me. I am the vine, you are the branches. He that abideth in me, and I in him, the same bringeth forth much fruit, for without me you can do nothing. If a man abide not in me, he is cast forth as a branch, and is withered. And men gather them, and cast them into the fire, and they are burned. If ye abide in me, and my words abide in you, ye shall ask what ye will, and it shall be done unto you. Herein is my Father glorified, that ye bear much fruit, so shall ye be my disciples. As the Father hath loved me, so I have loved you. Continue, yea, in my love. If you keep my commandments, ye shall abide in my love, even as I have kept my Father's commandments and abide in his love. Now I just want to take just a minute. We go back to Genesis and we think about what the intent was all about. The source was the tree. Everything that we needed was right there. And it was man's sin that got involved in the way that messed everything up. So God had to come up with some kind of plan so that he could put us back to where we needed to be. So he comes and he says, okay, we're going to send my son. We're going to send my son down and we're going to restore mankind so that I can have what I've always wanted. And that always wanted that relationship with man. I'll do what I have to do to the furthest extreme so that I can restore that which was lost. And he began to work on his plan. That relationship that was right in there in the garden, the evil that was brought forth, it was passed on from generation to generation. But then we look and we know that the Spirit of God allows us to be more fruitful and more fruitful. We know we walk around and we want to be able to have the good fruit. We want to make sure that no matter how we look at it, that we have a spirit abiding inside, deep inside of our heart, that we have a connection to the source, that we're connected to the vine, that we're part of everything that he wants us to be connected in. He says if we'll abide in him, he'll abide in us. He inhabits us, the praise of us. Once we understand all of these principles, then we won't have to worry about how all of these branches are going to be thrown out. We'll be secure in our thoughts. As long as we put every single ounce of our faith and trust in Jesus Christ, we'll know beyond a shadow of a doubt that we're not going to be cast off of the branch. We're not going to be pruned out, but we'll be able to have our branches to influence other branches. But we'll not be cast out. We'll produce right fruit, the correct fruit of what God has us to be produced. Others will be able to see God through us. That's how they'll know. We'll be able to influence branch to branch into a spiritual awakening across the land. That is the hope. That's the testimonies that we should have dear to our heart and want to spread across the globe. We want to be as close, having the commandments buried in our heart. The Bible tells us quickly that we're not under the law, but the covenant. We love Jesus Christ with all of our heart. All of the other commandments that we had will be embedded into us. And then we have the combination of the source and being connected spiritually, brought back to God. And we won't have to worry about being consumed in a fire off of any branch. We'll be right there, 100% connected at all times. We'll be having the Holy Ghost pure down into our heart so that whenever we get off, just off the road slightly, he'll be right there giving us a conviction so that we'll get right back exactly on the right path so that we don't accidentally go too far off and establish and get any kind of characteristics that we described across the seven churches. But we'll be pure and we'll be ready for the harvest. We want to make sure that no matter how we look at it, that we are ready for that harvest. We don't want to have our branches weak. We don't want to come find ourselves into any kind of time where they're it's time to do any kind of pruning. We want to make sure that whenever the time for the reaping is there, that we have the absolute pure fruits, and we're not going to be trampled where there's not any empathy or compassion. We don't want to find ourselves into that level at all. We want to make sure that we're there with Christ on the first gathering and the first reaping. We want to make sure that we don't have to get lost about in this world. We want to make sure that we stay on the path. He provides the light through every single path that we walk on. We just want to make sure that we don't step over into the darkness no matter what. We want to make sure that we hold fast to that path that He's already set us on. It's already planned and it's already there. Why would we want to go any different direction? We'll find so many surprises, and He'll have to spend all of our life trying to figure out how to get right back to where His plan was, where we should have been to begin with. This is His desire. He tells us in Galatians 6 and 7 through 8, be not deceived. God is not mocked, for whatsoever a man soweth, that he shall also reap. For he that soweth to his flesh shall of the flesh reap corruption. But he that soweth to the Spirit shall of the Spirit reap life everlasting. So as long as we're embodied in Christ, as long as we hold him fast like Paul tells us so many times, as long as we run that race and look forward to winning it with God on our side and going back to the previous chapter and remembering that we have those supporters all around us wishing us well to continue on, but we're encompassed about with such a cloud of great witnesses, as Hebrews 11 and 12 points out. We just have to keep pushing and keep pushing, as Paul describes it. Because there's going to be a time whenever whatever is left in us, whether it's corrupt fruit or whether it's the ripe fruit, there's going to be a time of judgment. And we want to make sure that we're attached to that great source and that vine. We're not the vine, but we want to be part of that vine. We want to be part of that branch. We don't want to be purged off and cast into the fire. We just have to make sure that we stay focused on Jesus and stay absolutely plugged into that source at all times. That's our source that we have today. Walk in the Spirit. We were kicked out of the garden long time ago. But Jesus Christ has already did all of the work for us. He's already paid all the price in full. He's made it. We have all the grace in the world. It's sufficient for anyone that so chooses to desire. He'll help us be pure and be absolutely ready for when the harvest comes, to have that perfect fruit and be ready so that we don't have to be trampled on, but we'll be rewarded for that which we've sown. Thank you so much for your time. Amen, amen.